My name is Joshua Morse. I am a student here at Grand Valley State University, and I will be your moderator today. Today we have a panel on the Big Five, African and Latin American topics in the world history curriculum. Today we have three associate professors of history from Grand Valley State University today to talk to you guys. We have Professor David Eaton, associate professor of history in the Africanus field. Michael Huener, who is also associate professor of history in the Latin American studies field. And then we have Professor David Zwart, also associate professor of history, and he's in social studies education, migration history, and Dutch American studies. They'll be coming up and talk to you guys about how we can use African and Latin American history topics in our world history curriculum. So, welcome.
So I'm just going to give a brief introduction to what we're hoping to accomplish in the next hour and a half, and then Dr. Eaton will go, and then Dr. Huener. So when we started thinking about what we could do, teaching world history, as we thought about it, at any level, is a complex intellectual challenge. Teachers have to have enough content knowledge to make the kinds of connections across time and space that the curriculum demands. Yet, there's an unlimited amount of content that could go into a world history classroom. But there are limits, no matter what level we teach at. Developmental level of our students has a limit, the amount of time we have, our own expertise, all kinds of things limit what's possible. Our hope is then that this session will give you some kind of idea of some ideas of content knowledge that might inspire you, some filters to help you sift through the content of world history, and we hope that by talking about Africa and Latin America and world history, provide some hooks and that inspiration for your own work in the classroom. So all of us have taught or are teaching Grand Valley State University's Introduction to World Civilization, literally History 101. Like all world history teachers, we make decisions about what content to include and what themes to emphasize. And we all bring expertise to the task, and so we all teach it a bit differently, emphasizing different aspects to accomplish the general education goals that the course fulfills as long as well as teaching it in a college course context. Some of us have taught it once a week for 3 hours, some of us have taught it twice a week for 75 minutes, some of us three times a week at 50 minutes, to all different range of students from first semester freshmen to seniors fulfilling that last requirement, so across a wide spectrum. So Drs. Eaton and Huener will give a brief overview of five big questions and ideas that relate to their regional expertise in world history. Then I will step in and give a few ideas about how to incorporate these into the pre-collegiate classroom and maybe to the college classroom as well. And we want this to be as inspiring as possible to think big about the world history curriculum. And we plan to leave plenty of time for questions and discussions. But as you can well imagine, when you get a couple of history professors up here talking about things they're passionate about, it's going to be hard to limit it. But we'll try. We're going to try really hard. So Dr. Eaton's going to start.
All right, I'm just going to hook on this microphone and then that. Is that going to work all right? All right, perfect. So for me, I'm coming to Grand Valley State originally as an Africanist, the emphasis very much on African history. However, when I got here, the expectation was that I would also teach Intro to World Civ. And History 101, oh my goodness, it is an adventure. Again, it's literally the history of everything that ever happened, ever. You can take it however you want. It's a challenge, there's no doubt about that. And what I'd like to do today is, Dr. Zwart has given me sort of five time periods or five time frames that are important in the Michigan curriculum as far as teaching world history. And what I want to do is give a couple of examples that have worked in my classroom, things that I've used in my classroom that I really enjoy that might not necessarily be familiar to you if you're not an Africa specialist. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start with the East African coast. And the East African coast, I've just provided a map of it here. This is the area along the Indian Ocean. This is a very beautiful part of East Africa. And it's also an area that'll work really, really well if you're looking at teaching world history before 1500. Before 1500, many people don't realize just how vibrant an area this was. This was really one of the trade emporiums of the world every way comparable to a place like, say, the Mediterranean. But it's hard to teach. And one of the reasons it's hard to teach is we actually don't have very many written sources about this time period. We have a few, a very small number. But how do we teach this? How do we get the students engaged in it? How do we trace the cosmopolitan trade links along that coast? And so one of the ways that gentleman John Mugani has just written a book called The Story of Swahili. And this is the story of the language that's spoken along this coast. And one of the things that I like to do in the classroom is to teach the story of the East African coast, teach the history of trade, the history of religion in that region using the Swahili language. And so the Swahili language is a beautiful language. I learned to speak it during my own research in Kenya and Uganda. And Swahili has a whole range of loan words. And this actually allows you to see certain key changes for the people who spoke it. So one of the examples of this, a word that I learned very early on, it's called mabati. Mabati just means corrugated iron sheets. So these are often used as roofs for people when they're building their houses. A house with mabati where I worked was generally seen as a pretty nice house. Now mabati, this word is actually originally part of Bantu languages. And so this is very interesting because Swahili is a Bantu language, but because we know mabati is shared by other Bantu languages as well, we can tell that very early on, Bantu speakers had access to iron. This is a word dealing with iron. Because it's present in all these different languages, we can make that very safe assumption, and indeed the archaeological record confirms it. That's one way to do it. A second word that I learned very early on was duka. Dukas are ubiquitous in Kenya. If any of you have been there, they're these little shops on street corners. Duka, though, is actually a borrowing from the Persian language. And so the Persians used dukan, a pronunciation I could be butchering there, but dukan was a word for market in Persian. And so this is another borrowing that tells us that the Swahili along that coast had contact with people speaking Persian. We have other words. Iliba is a word that's borrowed from Cushitic languages. This tells us about the migration of people from the Bantu core heartland in the Central African rainforest out into the East African grasslands. The reason we know this is Iliba was the Cushitic word for milk. And what's happened is that word has entered Swahili as maziwa. And this, again, was something that's a word that I was familiar with. The last thing I want to point out is the arrival of Arabic traders is something you can see in the Swahili language, the borrowing of words like dawa. Dawa comes from Arabic meaning medicine. We also have words for monotheistic, monotheistic words, I guess is the best way to put it. So shetani means devil in Swahili. This seems to be a reference to shaitan, an Arabic word for the devil as well. And we see this throughout. So you can begin to piece together a picture of the East African coast through these words. Now the last example I want to use is the arrival of Europeans. This would have happened about 1498, so I'm getting right on the edge of that 1500 boundary. But Fort Jesus is in Mombasa on the East African coast. This is where the Portuguese hold up when they establish their empire in this region, again, just after 1500. And it's fascinating to me because the Portuguese word for church, igreja, or igreja, this word actually enters the Swahili language as gereza. But gereza does not mean church, it actually means prison. And so there's this sense, the Portuguese, when they established this empire, they tended to stay right there. They stayed in their forts. And so it may have seemed quite a bit like a prison to the people observing. Again, it gives you an idea of the history of the East African coast using the vehicle of language. So that is my first example. That's for that time period. My second example is for those of you teaching the transatlantic slave trade. Teaching the transatlantic slave trade, I think, is difficult for a very different set of reasons. In a lot of ways, the trans-Saharan slave trade is perhaps the best documented aspect of Africa's past. If you go online, you can find a database where every single slave voyage across the Atlantic Ocean has been tracked. The number of people involved have been tracked. The origin port and destination port, to the best of these archivists' ability, have been traced as well. It is really remarkable. But the problem that I find is that it's often very difficult to convey, say, conditions during the Middle Passage. In a lot of ways, I think as teachers, we often end up telling rather than showing. We say, well, this is awful. And you know, it was horrible to be under the ships. I mean, the smell, the disease, all of this. But I think for students, it's very hard to empathize with that because it's just so removed from our own experiences, right? Very few of us are going to have anything comparable that we can look back on and say, oh yeah, it was like that. And so one of the ways, I think, to teach the slave trade and help it really hit home is by showing students the kind of world that the slave trade created, the kind of decisions that people made. And this, for this, I use the Zong. And the Zong was a slave trade vessel. It's going to travel from the West African coast, from the Cape Coast, over to Jamaica in 1782. It's going to be under the command of Captain Luke Collingwood. Captain Luke Collingwood was not really a trained navigator. He was not a trained sailor. He was a ship surgeon. And I know we have like this image now, like surgeons, oh, they're really smart, and they go to med school for a while. Surgeon back then meant you were handy with a saw. It was sort of a step below carpentry, but we're not talking about, you know, a particularly well-educated individual. Collingwood took charge of this ship primarily because he didn't get as ill as everybody else. He took over. His original captain gave him this ship. This was a prize that had been captured by the British. This ship collected 440 slaves and sailed across the Atlantic Ocean. And headed for Jamaica, and they just flat out missed. They went right by Jamaica. They saw Jamaica. They thought it was actually Saint-Domingue, and they just kept going. They didn't realize their mistake till after. They fought a headwind most of the way. It took them four times as long to get to the Caribbean as they would have planned on. And what happened is the slaves on the ship were becoming very ill. Dysentery had become a real problem. And so Captain Collingwood faced a bit of a problem. He didn't get paid by a salary. He got paid on commission. And he realized that the slaves, because they were so ill, they were so emaciated, they weren't actually going to be able to sell them when they got to Jamaica and make any money. But what Captain Collingwood knew was that this ship had insurance. And insurance meant that the slaves were insured for a particular value against perils of the sea, say if the ship ran out of water. So what Collingwood did is he gathered the crew together and he said, listen, we're going to say we're running out of water and we're going to throw slaves overboard that are too ill to sell. So the first day they threw about 50 slaves overboard. The second day they threw another 40. The third day, the slaves start fighting back because they see they have nothing to lose. There's this moment that's recorded that the slaves jump to their death in chains rather than be thrown overboard. It was kind of this moment of defiance. This is going to be what becomes known as the Zong Massacre. Now, it's a crazy story. One of the slaves is able to get into the rigging of the ship, hang on to some rigging that was dragging in the water. That slave's going to survive. The first mate, James Kelsall, began to have real reservations about the whole massacring dozens and dozens of people. But they get to Jamaica and they say, hey, 100-odd slaves died. We were running out of water. We had to throw them overboard. And what happens next is what makes this story really compelling. What happens next is that the captain of the ship makes an insurance claim. And he says, listen, he goes to the insurance company, he says, listen, we need to be compensated for these slaves. And the thing is, Kelsall tells the British colonial government, no, you don't have to pay this. They just threw the slaves overboard. And so, knowing this, Collingwood goes on trial, not for massacring 133 people, but for insurance fraud. Now think about that for a moment. Again, this isn't me telling you about the horrors of the slave trade, right? This is me showing you the decisions that were a result of this. And for me, I find this much more effective with students. That the Zong case really hits home that, okay, people really were treated like cargo. We're treated like things, not like human beings. And I think the logic of the Zong trial really makes this clear. In the end, eventually, after going through the courts, the insurance company didn't have to pay the insurance claim. So I don't know if that's really a victory or not. But it did end up being memorialized in this image by, I believe it's Turner, the slave ship. This painting has sort of become a representation of the massacre on the Zong. All right, the next example I want to do, again, for this time period, I believe this is Global Revolution, 1700 to 1914. And there's a lot of really remarkable things happening during this time. Again, you've got the Industrial Revolution, French Revolution, American Revolution, all sorts of ground to cover. For me, as an Africanist, one of the things, though, that's going to be really important is the gradually increasing African presence or European presence in Africa. It's going to become very important during the later 19th century when you're going to see colonial conquest taking place on a broad scale. You're going to see people like the Herero completely annihilated as Europeans conquered, in that case, Southwest Africa, what becomes known as Namibia. And so one of the things I try and do in my course is trace how that could happen, how Europeans began to see themselves as in charge, as superior to Africans. And the example I use in my course is the example of Sarah Bartman. So Sarah Bartman is pictured here. She was also known as the Hottentot Venus. And Sarah Bartman, her life has actually recently been done in a very detailed biography by Clifton Crace and Pamela Scully. And this book tries to recreate Sarah Bartman's life. She was born in the Karoo in South Africa in the, I believe it was about 1760. She ended up becoming effectively a slave or a forced laborer on a Dutch farm there. Eventually, she moved to Cape Town with an agent. An agent of a Dutch merchant. She was able to gain her freedom there. To an extent, she ended up working in the house of that agent for years to come. However, what's going to happen is in 1806, after the Napoleonic Wars had sort of swept through South Africa, there'd been a British invasion. The person who, we don't know if he owned her or not, but her, again, agent is the term I'm using, he ended up in huge debt to a Dutch merchant named Voss. And what he decided to do was to begin to use Sarah Bartman as entertainment. So Sarah Bartman was taken to a hospital where sick soldiers were recovering from war wounds, from diseases, and they could pay money to see her or to touch her. And the emphasis from a very early stage was on her butt. Her butt was seen as being abnormally large, and that this was kind of the erotic dimension to it, the erotic kind of fetish. Now, this is going to go on for a couple years when a guy named Alexander Dunlop, who is a surgeon, again, a surgeon, very much in that carpentry sense, he was actually working at the hospital. He knew his time was up, and so he was going to be on a very small pension going forward. And he thought, you know what, Sarah Bartman shouldn't just be stuck in South Africa. I could take her to London and make her a star. Make her the centerpiece of an edutainment act. So Sarah Bartman's going to be taken to London. In London, she's going to become known as the Hottentot Venus. She would be presented to audiences wearing tribal regalia and then a skin-colored tight suit. British, even the nobility, the Duke of Queensbury, is going to pay money to have her taken to his palace in a sedan chair, and then she's going to be groped by him. She's going to be in the middle of this kind of, this gawking crowd. Going to become a sensation for a while. Then rumors are going to get out that the person who brought her there, not Alexander Dunlop, but the agent, is her slave owner. That would have been illegal in Britain. It leads to a trial. And Sarah Bartman ends up, the show ends up losing a lot of its sexual dimension after that point. It becomes a little more serious. This also made it much less popular. She's going to end up in traveling circuses for a while. She's going to then, at long last, wait a sec, where did I put my clicker? Here we go. She's going to end up going to France. And in France was really the place to be in 1814, 1815. She's going to go there and meet this guy. This is George Cuvier. George Cuvier was a French, renowned French biologist, one of the founders of sort of human biology. And so while she was still doing the Hottentot Venus Act in Paris, he is going to take an interest in her. And he thought Hottentots were sort of a separate classification of Homo sapiens known as Homo sapiens monstrous. And this idea for him was that Hottentots were basically the missing link between human beings and beasts. Now, Hottentot, the word itself means to stammer. And this is because Khoisan languages, they have a click sound, sort of a. And that click was seen to represent this kind of animalistic link. So Cuvier wanted to essentially take a look at her naked. So her genitalia, her butt, see if those revealed to him whether she was an animal or not. And what's really fascinating, she's going to refuse. She's alive. She's going to refuse to let him paint her naked. She spends 3 days in a museum with him, but she refuses to do this. 1815, Napoleon's going to come back. He's going to be defeated, and Paris is going to be in a nightmare shape. She's going to get pneumonia and die. Cuvier is then going to acquire her corpse after she's died, and he's going to dissect her, perform a full dissection on her body, take plaster molds of her entire body. It stayed in France until 2002, and he's going to say the results confirm his thing. This is very much rape by science, right? So for me, Sarah Bartman does give you a good idea of sort of the intellectual climate. That in some ways, you know, we teach the Enlightenment, it's a very sort of celebratory thing. Cuvier was very much an Enlightenment thinker, but this did have some very dark undertones for people who maybe weren't part of the global core, people who weren't accepted as equal. All right, next example I want to give, I'm going to go a little bit quicker here. I know I got to give my other colleagues time. This is a picture of Elizabethville. This is taken from the Congo. The Congo has a bit of a reputation today as being a basket case. However, there's a history to that. And that history is very much linked to Cold War politics. And so if you're teaching something like, say, the Cold War, if you're looking at it from an American perspective, maybe a European perspective, Cold War is an applicable term. If you're looking at it from certainly a Latin American perspective or an African perspective, it definitely is not. Cold War interventions had real consequences in these places, resulting in the deaths of millions and millions of people, crippling new nations in the process. So this is a copper mine. The Congo initially settled by King Leopold as his private domain. He raped it for ivory, for rubber. Eventually, the Belgians took it over. They weren't that much better. They end up setting up copper and cobalt mines. And they stayed more or less unchallenged in power until after World War II, when this man, Patrice Lumumba, began to lead pressure against the Belgians. He began to agitate for independence. Patrice Lumumba was a postal worker. He had a fifth grade education. He was then self-taught after that. He was a very talented orator. He worked as a beer salesman for a while, which was a good way for him to kind of hone those political skills. He wanted to set up an independent central state under African rule. No more white colonialism to get the Belgians out. The Belgians tried to resist him. They threw him in jail for a while. It did not work. It just gained him more popularity. Eventually, in 1960, he was able to win an election and became the first legal elected prime minister in the Congo. And this is where the Cold War happens. Because the thing was, you couldn't just be anti-Belgian in the Cold War. Because the Belgians were NATO allies of the United States. And so being anti-Belgian was seen as being very dangerous. One of the things Lumumba wanted to do was to have a central country. This would have meant that he would have been in control of the mines, this case in Katanga. So the Belgian government did everything in their power to undermine Patrice Lumumba's authority. So this undermining took a whole variety of forms. In this case, most important one you're going to want to know about is they fueled a civil war. They got Katanga to declare independence. This civil war, Lumumba tried to get U.S. help to resolve it. They wouldn't do it. He tried to get U.N. help. The U.N. didn't really help. They just provided cover for a Belgian intervention to protect white people. And so Patrice Lumumba is going to ask the Soviet Union for help. They're not going to offer anything either. As soon as that happened, though, Dwight Eisenhower approved Lumumba's assassination. The Belgians had $400,000 of their own intelligence money committed to an assassination plan as well. The one the Americans used on him is pretty crazy. They actually tried to assassinate him with snake venom. They got a guy named Larry Devlin, who was their CIA chief of station in the capital city, to try and do this. He ultimately failed at it. But in the end, the Americans were able to get President Mobutu. President Mobutu to take the reins. He led a military coup. Mobutu ended up getting a whole lot of American tax money, somewhere around $5-6 billion in value in aid money that was given no strings attached to prop him in power. Patrice Lumumba was arrested, detained, fled, arrested again, and then killed by Belgian intelligence. So this story, again, gives you an idea of the consequences. Congo was never the same, right? Never able to develop as a nation. A big part of that's the Cold War context. My last example, I know this might be a bit of a confusing picture when we're talking about African history. Last example is for modern global topics, very recent global topics. The one I love to use is because it's pretty grim sometimes talking about African history. I like to use soccer as my final look, using it as a microcosm for the global economy. And soccer came to Africa during the colonial period. It became very popular across many African nations. Today, you're going to see a lot of African players in the top European leagues. And Africans have slowly been transforming soccer from the inside. This is the French team, French Olympic team in 1920. This is the French national team during the 2006 World Cup. There's a bit of a change there, right? The African diaspora has become critical to athletic success for many European nations. The reason I use it as a microcosm for the global economy is twofold. The first is, if you are a talented African player, globalization has opened up new opportunities for you. One of the individuals for whom these opportunities have opened up is Michael Essien. Michael Essien, one of my favorite players, he's a defensive midfielder for Chelsea. He was playing in Ghana in their top league for Liberty Professionals. In that position, he could make about $700 a week. He moved to Chelsea and he was able to make $110,000 a week. Not bad, right? If you're talented, the new global economy offers you access to these new pathways to wealth, to fame. But on the other hand, the problem with this is that African League has lost its best player. It has no real way to compete with, say, the Premier League, where the TV money involved gives teams resources that African clubs just don't have. And this dilemma on sort of the benefits or the consequences of globalization is one that's very real, and I think is one that's been experienced by numerous African individuals migrating to play football. I'm going to have to leave it at that. I know I've gone too long. Thank you very much for listening. I'll be happy to take questions after.
Thank you, and oh, I should put the mic on here, shouldn't I? Try to do this. Well, I'll try to follow that up quite nicely. I don't necessarily have the kind of the individual stories that Professor Eaton presented. Although I do have one really good one, which includes a sitting president committing suicide while in office. But we'll get there in a moment. I designed this around five kind of essential questions in terms of addressing Latin American history and global connections within Latin American history. To kind of talk about a broad span of time, as well as, again, getting at to some of the fundamental significances, relevances of Latin American history on the global stage. And so I kind of cheated, actually, a little, because I combined sometimes two questions into one question. That's the best I could do, because Professor Swartz said, you got to break this down to five topics, and covering more than 500 years of history in five questions is tough. So bear with me, as sometimes these are two questions packed into one, right? But my first question to address, especially the global significance of Latin America, is why did Native American empires emerge, and then why did they fall? Right. Now, both within the two major sedentary, I should say, the two major regions of sedentary state building and civilization making in the Americas prior to the arrival of Europeans on American shores, both those regions really didn't see what I would call imperial scale states emerge until literally the century before Europeans did arrive on American shores. And of course, those two empires you probably heard of, they often referred to as, I'm going to trip over myself here, as the Aztec Empire. But of course, the Aztecs didn't know themselves as the Aztecs. They called them Mexica, or Tenochtitlan. And then the Inca Empire in the Andes. Right? Both these two are very powerful, very wealthy states. They emerged over the course of the 1400s. But in both these regions, again, they were very fragmented regions politically, socially, very diverse regions ethnically and linguistically. So the fact that these two empires emerge in the 100 years before Europeans arrive on American shores is something of considerable global significance, right? It was an important, what historians might call global contingency or conjuncture to occur. To forge these empires at that moment. And so recognizing that global contingency in conjuncture in terms of something that's happening autonomously in the Americas is something I like to highlight when I'm addressing the global significance of Latin American, pre-colonial Latin American historical developments. And of course, this helps illustrate that when you're addressing Native American peoples in the Americas, they're not caught in formaldehyde bottles. Right? Where they're just unchanging over time. You ever hear that expression, the ancient Aztec Empire or the ancient Inca Empire? You read it in textbooks still. It makes me want to throw myself out the window, right? Because these are not ancient empires by all means. They are early modern empires, right? If we were talking about ancient empires, we would refer to things that would be contemporaneous with other ancient states or civilizations, right? But they emerged during the 1400s, okay? And so that's pretty critical because when these empires do fall at the hands of Iberians of all people, the Iberians are going to construct their own colonial empire over the foundations that these empires lay, okay? And that's really important to recognize the contributions of Native American peoples, states, and institutions to something of as globally significant as the Spanish colonial empire. But we'll get to that in a moment. Why did they fall? Again, I'm not covering a whole lot of things that necessarily should be covered in terms of the dynamics of the rise of these two empires. But of course, this brings up oftentimes a very Eurocentric-oriented question. Right, in terms of how did 500 armed men representing a European crown show up and conquer these powerful empires that could mobilize armies in the tens of thousands, right? And it seems to suggest all this stuff of European superiority, whether that would be defined as cultural superiority, racial superiority, armed technology and arms superiority, or superiority in their use of arms and all these sorts of things. And while, of course, we could probably definitively argue that racial or cultural or ethnic superiority did not play a factor, oftentimes historians continue to emphasize the role of their alleged superiority in arms, as well as the role of disease, all of which played a role in the fall of these major, very powerful, very wealthy empires in the Americas at the hands of armed adventurers representing the Spanish crown. Yes, that was a critical factor, but perhaps the most critical factor, the one that I argue, was the role of indigenous allies, right? They had to make allies on the ground. And of course, that's exemplified by this great Tlaxcalan lienzo, a critical ally of the Spanish in the conquest of Tenochtitlan, where if you see, this is a depiction of the conquest of Tenochtitlan, and where are the Spanish standing. These are Tlaxcalan warriors facing off against Mexica warriors, right? Whose conquest was this, really? Right. Great question I love to ask. Moving on. My next question, why did the Spanish colonial empire endure? And how did the Portuguese forge and expand the Atlantic slave trade? Well, this is where it's going to connect with what Professor Eaton talked about a little bit. But first, why did the Spanish colonial empire endure? If you could boil it down to a single word, it would be silver, right? The production of silver, right? And silver coming out of the Spanish colonial empire essentially becomes the global currency of the early modern world. Why? Who wants so much silver? Yes, the Europeans want it, but who's actually absorbing all this production of silver on the global stage? Not so much still warring and still relatively poor Western European kingdoms and states. It's China and India, right? They're absorbing, because China, especially China, Imperial China, had made silver the currency in which they were collecting taxes in under the Ming Dynasty, and that set up the global demand for silver to make the Spanish colonial empire successful and possible. But of course, none of this production of silver could have happened, right, without the indigenous American social and political institutions that the Spanish relied upon to channel labor to the major silver mines, especially Potosi in the Andes. Right? The famous Mita, which was actually an Inca imperial institution that the Spanish are now using to mine that silver. Of course, Mexico also, later on also becomes the major silver producer for the global economy during the 18th century. But that gets at two things. One, the global significance of the Spanish colonial empire, essentially producing at least the world's currency. But two, also the fact that the Spanish colonial empire was forged over the foundations, again, of indigenous American states and societies. And those foundations continued to function under Spanish colonial rule. Native Americans, once again, did not disappear, right? They're not just to be relics in a museum. They have colonial and post-colonial histories that play out, all right? Well, the next question, how did the Portuguese forge and expand the Atlantic slave trade? I like to show this graphic always to my students. Why? Because it actually breaks down where people are going in the Atlantic slave trade, okay? And yes, a huge bulk do go to the Caribbean and are shuttled by the likes of the British and the French to the Caribbean, but the largest bulk go to Brazil, right? And that's because the largest volume of the Atlantic slave trade was not being operated by the likes of the British or the French, right? It was being operated by the Portuguese. And so to understand the Atlantic slave trade, you need to understand the South Atlantic trade, which often gets forgotten about when talk about the Atlantic slave trade. Of course, you always should point out that what becomes the United States is receiving a very small portion of that trade, okay? And so the Portuguese slave trade in that regard, to understand, also has a profound global dimension because they're pulling most of their captives from West Central Africa, what is today Angola, all right? And what do West Central African political elites and merchant elites most want in exchange for captives with European merchants? Some would say guns, some would say rum. Those certainly were things that they wanted, but what they most wanted were Indian-made cotton textiles bought with New World silver through the Portuguese Indian Ocean commercial connections there. This is a global trade, not a triangular one. Of course, it's the slave trade and the production of sugar in Brazil, we should point out as well, that's sustaining the Portuguese empire, but soon also the mining of gold and diamonds in Brazil, which sustains the Portuguese colonial enterprise in Brazil and continues the free flow of captive Africans into Brazil as well into the 18th century and then even into the 19th century. Soon the cultivation of sugar is also going to continue that production. or at least that flow of people into Brazil, as well as the production of economic products of value on the global stage that's coming out of Brazil. The next question, why did the Spanish and Portuguese colonial empires collapse, and why were the results so messy and cruel? This, by the way, this moment of oftentimes it's referred to as the age of revolutions, global revolutions that do impact Latin America, in many ways also should be highlighted for its significance, because it's the first great wave of global decolonization, one that precedes the one that occurs in the 20th century post-World War II. And so to get a sense of how global decolonization could play out, or did play out, later on in places like Africa or South Asia or Southeast Asia, Latin America was an early laboratory of some of the tensions and problems and violence that occurs as a result of a wave of global decolonization. But what's important to point out about the collapse of the Spanish and Portuguese colonial empires at the beginning of the 19th century was that this wasn't the product of this kind of welling up, bottom-up revolution that we always like to depict in terms of the way revolutions play out, right? It was really that. It was imperial collapse, okay? There was the Napoleonic invasion of the Iberian Peninsula, which set both of these empires into a tailspin, okay? And what they produced initially was waves of what I call intra-imperial civil wars, which only after some 15 years does the option of exit become the most viable option. That is the exit from empire. That is, people were fighting over lots of things within, especially Spanish America, before leaders like Simon Bolivar and other Republican, anti-monarchic, anti-Spanish colonial leaders really rose to the forefront. So this was really about a period of imperial collapse before it became really about kind of revolutions trying to bring down monarchy and its associated institutions. So that's a very complicated story to tell, because what it does, although it's complicated, it nonetheless helps set up the kind of the second part of that question, at least with respect for Spanish America, and that is, why were these results so messy? One of the things that, of course, we like to do, especially from the United States, when comparing the early post-colonial history of the United States with Spanish American republics, is to kind of pound our chest and say, oh, look how stable the United States was compared to these Spanish American republics, which were wrought in civil war and in political instability. And so there's a degree of historical truth to that, but to understand that instability, where there's a lot of ongoing civil war after the collapse of Spanish colonial rule, and changes of constitutions and changes of presidents and all these sorts of things, to be able to understand that, you have to understand that the post-colonial sovereignties of these states were highly unresolved. What do I mean by sovereignties? Well, what does it even mean to be a post-colonial republic, right? What sort of form of government should you rule? How should the people be represented? And what should you do with these old colonial institutions? Should you embrace them and try to make them kind of the bastions of your new independent state? Or should you try to eliminate them altogether? And so those were the nature of some of the fights playing out, especially in Spanish American republics. And Brazil is a kind of a different story, right? Brazil is really the story of literally the Portuguese monarch trying to escape Napoleon, coming to Brazil to live and rule in Rio de Janeiro in 1808. Right? And this helped set up the early post-colonial history of Brazil, because what it results in is eventually the son of that monarch, Pedro I, declares Brazil's independence as still a monarchic slavecratic empire. Right? So a European dynasty continues to rule in Brazil, but that allows it to maintain its political stability to some extent, while nonetheless still relying on slavery as kind of the basis of its wealth, and of course the basis of its social order. All right. Got 5 minutes. Oh boy. All right. So. Quite quickly here, jumping ahead to 1954, my next question is, why did Getulio Vargas, the president of Brazil, commit suicide? He actually commits suicide in office in 1954, right? And I jump ahead to 1954 because the suicide of Getulio Vargas is a nice terminus point to kind of track the major changes that occur in Latin America roughly between 1870 and the 1940s, and show how a different, to show first kind of the nature of Latin American, the nature of Latin American economies and states in that period, roughly between 1870 and 1930, as well as the changes that take place, especially post-1930, that kind of wrapped up in Getulio Vargas himself. And so, to be very brief here, again, between 1870 and 1930 especially, Latin America was very much defined by autocratic states whose main orientation was producing commodities for the global industrial economy. And in much the same way that colonized African states were. And so that usually meant a lot of money for the elites of those states and a lot of power for the autocratic leaders of those states. But then practices reflective of old colonial times under Spanish colonial rule actually being intensified in terms of the alienation and exploitation of everyday people, people who are typically of indigenous and African descent. And that dynamic only changes with the Great Depression, where certain Latin American states begin to heavily industrialize. They actually put up high tariffs to protect their own industries. And you see the emergence of certain populist leaders who try to change also the internal political dynamics of their countries to make them more inclusive. And Getulio Vargas is one guy who does that. But due to kind of some of the political strife that he faces by the 1950s as an elected president, he actually ends up committing suicide in 1954 and leaving this incredible suicide note, right? Which would be a great thing for students to look at as a primary source in class. And again, I can't go into the particulars of the note right now about it because I don't have time, but it really demonstrates the changes in Latin American political dynamics between the so-called neo-colonial period and the new nationalist period post-1930. Finally, and this gets to a question or an issue that certainly Professor Eaton addressed, why was the Cold War so hot in Latin America, right? Does anyone know who these two figures are up here? Does anyone recognize them? No, good guess. Yeah. This is Fidel Castro, young Fidel Castro. And of course, this is a dreamy Che Guevara, right? And you can't understand why the Cold War got so hot in Latin America without understanding the 1959 Cuban Revolution, right? But that allows, the 1959 Cuban Revolution also helps, it's kind of a focal point for us to think about why some right-wing military regimes that take power in Latin America post the Cuban Revolution become so violent against their own populations, right? And to understand that violence and why it became so virulent and nasty, both in South America and Central America, you need to understand some of the internal dynamics of those Latin American societies, but also how those connected up with global Cold War rivalries, right? But again, we can't understand these Latin American states who might be participating in this global Cold War conflict as mere puppets of either the Soviet Union or the United States. They had their own issues and interest at stakes, and that kind of helps illustrate in many ways the virulence of the violence in Latin America how rabid it becomes in during the time of the Cold War. And finally, we should also point out that the Cold War was multilateral. In terms of, especially Cold War interventions. Again, when we think about Cold War interventions, we think just in terms of the United States and the Soviet Union. But often what's forgot about is this, especially in terms of Latin America, is this major Cold War intervention led by Cuba in Angola. Right? The prop up a socialist regime in Angola, where literally Cuba sent tens of thousands of troops, but even more doctors, teachers, and engineers to Cuba. And this is a defining experience for many of the 1970s generation in Cuba, their service in Angola. And this was, again, a Cold War military intervention led by Cuba with the help of the Soviet Union. So to understand why Cuba did this, right, begins to also explain why the Cold War became so hot in Latin America, because Cuba has their own third world politics at stake in this intervention as well. So I think I also have gone over, and I will stop right there. And not as good of stories as Professor Eaton, but still, hopefully some intriguing stuff. Yeah.
Now, as much as I would love to talk about migration in world history, or even better yet, the Dutch in world history, which would be endlessly fascinating, my job is to take what these guys have hopefully piqued your interest about and think about, well, what would this actually look like if we would take some of the ideas they expressed and put them into the classroom? So a couple metaphors maybe to start. Anybody know what this is? Yeah, well, you guys do, I know. Anybody else know what this is? Here, let me help you. It shakes a little bit. Anybody know what that is? What is it?
A
soil sieve, right? A soil sieve. Because one of the issues we all have when we teach is we can't put everything in it we would love to, right? I was watching these guys very hard, telling them you have to keep to 20 minutes, and they pushed it, right? Because we have so much stuff we want to say, so how are we going to filter this down while at the same time being ambitious? The other metaphor I often use is this. It's a sandbox. We all teach with limits. And we all teach within what we can and can't do given the context that we're in. But I would hope that maybe beginning teachers start with a castle that looks like this, but since it is art prize season in Grand Rapids, that maybe some people, even in a small, very confined space, can build castles that look like this one from about 2 years ago downtown, right? So my goal here is to help us see what's perhaps possible by using a couple of recognizing where the limits are, but also what's possible. So another starting point is my definition of world history that I try to use: a discipline with a set of practices to approach seeing and interpreting the world systematically in order to successfully traverse the world today. Right? There's lots of stuff we can do. Again, there's lots of ways to see it. This definition actually comes from some of the standards documents of how we think about what are we trying to accomplish in a world history classroom at the K-12. Another starting point is Michigan is just working through a draft of a new revision of social studies standards. Okay, this one is from August, so it's pretty new. Not a lot adjusted, other than a lot of more process, you would call it, in there, a lot more thinking skills. And then the other one is from the National Council for Social Studies. It's called the C3 Framework for Social Studies State Standards. Again, much more about the historical thinking skills that go into the practice of teaching. So the first example I want to do is soccer in Africa. Can we imagine how we could use soccer as a hook, as a tool to teach in the classroom? All right, and particularly in soccer. And this, in my mind, could fit in this 20th century since 1945 era. So in the high school curriculum, that's the era eight, the Cold War and its aftermath this whole time, as well as patterns of global interaction. That's how Dr. Eaton talked about it. But it might, you could use this as the tool, as the vehicle to teach about these things. So era five, Cold War and its aftermath, since 1945. Two main things here to look at. Talking about how to analyze global configurations and restructuring of political and economic relations in the post-World War II era. Again, thinking about, can soccer help us get students engaged in thinking about that big idea of the Cold War, the conflicts, the end, and then some maps. And then also, the second part of Era Aid is assess and compare regional struggles for and against independence, decolonization, democracy across the world. And I think Professor Eaton's picture of the French national team does a nice job of showing that kind of a decolonization, independence, the global movement of people. All right. So those are a starting place, thinking about that. We also start with this patterns of global interaction. Talks about defining the process of globalization, evaluate the merits of the concept to describe the contemporary world by analyzing economics, exchanges, cultural diffusions, economic advantages and disadvantages, distribution of wealth. He gave the example of $750 a week, correct?
Yes.
$750 a month work playing in the African League versus $100,000+ playing in a per week in the European leagues, all right? So again, an example that might be helpful. Finally, in the social studies standards, the new ones, is a lot of these process and skills ones. So students have to use appropriate strategies to read and analyze, interpret primary and secondary documents, explain points of agreement, express social science ideas in written, spoken, and graphic forms, construct and present an argument. Lots of stuff we're trying to accomplish. And it goes on, they have to have inquiry and research and analysis, and they have to be able to discuss publicly and make decisions, and they have to get involved. Everybody excited for this challenge now? This is the intellectual work of being a teacher, I think. How are you going to construct units of study that can actually do all this stuff? Right? So let's think about this together. The tool that I would like to use for that is what's called the C3, this new NCSS framework called the Inquiry Arc. And I'll walk you through it a little bit. And it's trying to get us to imagine doing history. Okay? Doing history, not just marching through a textbook or the standards. Both of these are helpful, of course, but actually engaging in intellectually honest ways to help students see and interpret the world. So the first thing that we have to do as we start to construct this is, how do we get them engaged? And so the starting point is compelling questions, they're called. So what could we imagine to be a compelling question about soccer in Africa for the Cold War and for the globalization? Okay, so just sit and think, maybe jot something down. We'll ask for examples here in a second. I'll give you a second to think, I'll shut up. Anybody wanna give an example that might work? I know it's a tough crowd. It's tough. This is the intellectual work, but it's exciting too, because you can imagine what's possible here. Say, so I'll use the one that I came up with. Why did soccer become such a popular sport in Africa after 1945? Does that work, Dr. Eaton? Could that function? Could we find some stuff? All right. So part of what you have to do is get students excited about thinking about soccer, which might not be hard when the United States is playing El Tri tonight for a chance to go to the Confederations Cup here next summer. There was a great article in Sports Illustrated just about some of these identities of Mexican Americans. Which generation cheers for whom? And I would imagine the same thing could happen in a place throughout Africa and in Europe. And you know, who are they cheering for? Okay, so why did soccer become such a popular sport? Then the C3 asks us, well, all right, that's the big question, but we need to break it down into other subset questions. They call these supporting questions. So I see these supporting questions as the kind of smaller sub-questions of the big question. They make sure that we kind of that we are hitting all of the standards, covering what needs to be covered, whereas the compelling question are the ones that we can explore and talk about and disagree about. Okay. So again, here's a couple of examples, maybe a little bit too long, but when did Africans start playing soccer, why and where? So some of that background. Thinking about, how does it relate to the political forces of the Cold War? How does it relate to economic forces of the Cold War? Does it play a role in nationalism and independence movement in Africa, and how? How did African leaders and or people use soccer? How does it relate to globalization? And how does it relate to identity in the globalized world? So starting to get some questions that we can actually start to investigate to answer the bigger, compelling question by the end of that unit. Questions on that? Something that's not quite clear? Trying to break stuff down. Yeah, Sean?
I would like to know what other questions might be for your compelling question.
Okay. No, the water. So you think students might not care on that question, or teachers?
I mean, is it really significant, soccer in Africa?
Well, and this is when I'm teaching this, what I try and do is I use those two pictures as kind of the entry point where I ask them, you know, why do you think this has changed so much? You know, what has led to this complete transformation of a very visible aspect of the French team? And I have the students begin with that. So looking at changes like immigration, again, it was almost impossible if you were a talented African player to move to Europe before the 1990s. There were quotas on how many non-European players could be on a European team. Each nation wanted to keep its best players home because most of what they cared about was national level soccer, which isn't really compensated very well. And so for African players, they would have very limited opportunities to move or to migrate. And so this whole change is a very, very recent one. 1990s is really the beginning of the time where if you were African, you could move to Europe to play soccer. And a lot of students, I think, don't realize that this open world where you can just move from one country to another, where your talent can sort of move you around that way, that's even possible. That was even not possible at an earlier stage. And that's what I'm trying to convey.
Yeah, and I think the compelling question might not be the hook question for the unit yet. In my thinking, that we still need to find that hook, and that's going to vary from classroom to classroom. So, yeah, Jim.
I have to go out for a few minutes, so I missed some of the presentation. I'm sorry for that. But this reminds me, there's a scholar in Singapore. I can't remember the name of the center there. It's to do really with the Middle East and Islam. And he focuses mainly on the Islamic world, but particularly on the Middle East. But he uses soccer as a way of really unpacking everything political, economic, within the region, and talks about power
yep.
Tensions over power and so forth, particularly in Egypt with military government and popular forces there.
Oh, okay,
there.
Yeah.
And he's particularly been focusing on Qatar and this whole issue about world soccer and should it be there and the way it treats contract laborers and so forth. So I would think that some of the questions you have below, for me anyway, would be the more important ones about, how did African leaders and our people use soccer?
Right.
Or higher up there about the Cold War or whatever. But I mean, I just think this is an entree into everything. Right?
Yeah, and Dr. Huner would say that it's a perfect entree into Latin American history in this era as well, that these are things that matter to people. As an identity issue, as a globalized movement of players, right? Brazil, think of all the Brazilian players and Messi, and it just keeps going and can spiral.
And there's a proliferation of really good recent scholarship on this, too, I think, in ways that you're alluding to, Jim, in multiple regions of the world, Africa as well.
If you look at the individual picture, you can look at individuals in that picture. So look at Zidane, the one who looks like he might not be African, but he is African, but in a completely different way,
right,
in representing certain issues of class and culture that go really deep in all sorts of different ways.
Right. So this is any question that we're going to come up with, right? And this is just mine. You're going to have to find it for your classroom, for what gets into the class, how it works. But these are ways to actually help students start to do history and to orientate your classroom towards the active engagement with, the second part, investigating using historical practices, right? That you start to help students investigate what's going on. And the C3 breaks this down into a couple ways. We talk about, well, what data sources do we use? Well, what do data sources do historians use? That's pretty straightforward, right? the primary and secondary sources. You have to find the information and evaluate it. So there's, over time as a teacher, you'd have to start to collect these kinds of things and become this kind of small expert on this to start to develop. Same way Mr. Brood yesterday talked about the becoming an expert on Ford and the assembly line, right? Over time, this isn't tomorrow. These are over time that we start to develop these things. Key concepts and understandings necessary to answer the question. So again, what are the kind of the substantive as far as what are the big words, the big ideas that they need to understand in order to understand this all, as well as what are the key historical thinking skills. So things students would have to understand something about the Cold War, nationalism, independence, decolonization, globalization. These are substantive concepts that students would have to be working with, they would have to become familiar with in order to investigate with historical practices. Then also the way historians think about, the way they think about context, change in continuity, agency, empathy, the list goes on and on. The National Council for History Education has a lovely two-paragraph talking about these kinds of things. Okay, and then finally, key strategies and skills, basically reading and analyzing, synthesizing, making claims, critiquing claims, you doing what we do. So even the quick conversation we had here about soccer is the kind of stuff we want students to be doing, to engage in. And it's our job then as teachers to find the prompts, the documents, the ways to get students into thinking about all of this stuff. Because as I showed you, it's a lot of stuff to keep track of, right? And then we evaluate historical claims using evidence, state the claims, write the claims, discuss the claims, critique the claims, change the claims, assess the claims, right? We're making claims. I think actually I was yesterday going to a couple of different sessions too. I think finding good secondary sources might actually be harder sometimes than the primary sources that are reading appropriate level for students in the classroom. The primary sources, we can track those down. But who's making these kinds of short, readable, you know, second claims that then they can assess with the evidence that are classroom appropriate even in a high school classroom, as this example is. All right, and then ask new questions. Historians go back and forth and they ask new questions, find new evidence. This isn't just a one thing deal. It's this active engagement with these ideas. And then finally, communicate historical conclusions. What do you do with what you know? Now that you've thought about soccer, thought about the global context, thought about the Cold War, what does that matter? This is very much a social studies move. Then also helping you transfer that learning. How do you take what you've learned there and transfer it onto something else, right? So that's the soccer one. How about the other one is, this is a seventh grade example, and I'll do this one a little bit quicker now that you see what I was trying to accomplish there. Native American empires in Latin America. So this is the pre-1500 in the new Michigan standards. It's a seventh grade topic. So this is the seventh grade kind of quick overview. Again, trying to do lots of stuff. How are we going to do all that stuff if we could just have one unit here, one unit here, one unit here, one unit here? But how do we do something maybe a little more fully encompassing, a case study type approach? So these include historical habits of the mind, again, evaluating evidence, comparing and contrasting information. It includes inter-regional and comparative expectations. So there is one clearly in there that talks about analyzing and comparing important hemispheric interactions. Did I skip one? Oh yeah, I did. All right. So before we get to there's a regional expectations that students will have studied something about the Americas prior to 1500 in seventh grade, and that they'll connect this to larger issues at the interregional or comparative expectations, and then even larger at a global region. So there's these levels of expectations in the Michigan seventh grade world history. How do you connect these all onward, okay? So, again, a compelling question is where the good place is to start to kind of organize what you're going to try to accomplish in the 3 to 4 weeks that you're going to spend doing this. So maybe, why did Native American empires emerge and why did they fall? Sounds very familiar, right, Dr. Huner? Right? Why did they emerge and fall? What's going on within them that makes them unique? And I think the soccer one, I'm not sure if you're going to find much about soccer in your world history textbook. right? Probably not. This one, you're going to find some stuff, right? This one's ambitious, but less ambitious, I would say, because there is stuff in your textbook about this one. And again, developing those supporting questions to help think about why they emerged and fell. And here's another list of questions, trying to cover that stuff in the expectations and the standards. How are the empires the same and different? How do we know about them? Dr. Huner talked about that a little bit. Did they interact with other groups? Again, talked about that. What was their religion? How did they change over time? How does geography matter? How does political life matter? How does economics matter? All these kinds of things, trying to pull them all into this unit where students are doing the history. So again, investigating with the sources, thinking about empire as a substantive concept, emperor, Native American, religion, economics, all these words that as historians we often take for granted. Then talking about sources, points of view, change in continuity, and context, agency. And these aren't things that you just tell students, in my experience, teaching this, trying to teach in this way at the college level, for sure, and supervising student teachers. But it's about building a rich classroom that just automatically does these kinds of things. And then finally, reading, analyzing, synthesizing, making claims, critiquing claims, evaluating claims, using evidence. Again, that claim making, asking questions, finding new evidence before communicating. You know, what do we do with this now that we know it? What do we do with it? How does it connect to today? And can you transfer that learning about why empires emerge and fall? Right? So in that brief 20 minutes, I tried to hope, and what Drs. Huner and Eaton did, hopefully we gave you some hooks, some new information, help maybe think about ambitious teaching. That encompasses the content that we need to teach, but also those skills that are built into the new standards with the inquiry arc, give models for thinking about how to organize some instruction in world history. You can't do it all, so what are you gonna do? So with that, we'll be excited to talk for the next 20 minutes, so thanks.
Questions for panelists?
We answered them all. You're all excited to go do this now, right? To teach in an ambitious, crass way.
Yeah, I just have an observation, and that is that a lot of us in the history department at Grand Valley, I mean, we do a lot of similar things, interesting things, that could have a lot of relationship, could enrich our classes and our teaching and what our students get out of our classes, but I feel that I'm isolated and separate from this. I'm not aware until I come and hear you talk about what you do, how what you do interacts with what I do.
Yeah.
And maybe, clearly from what you said, you present material in both in ways and content which I could benefit from, and I would like to think vice versa. But so it'd be interesting to think about a forum in which somehow this could happen, you know, instead of the occasional invitation to visit a class or whatever.
I appreciate that. Yeah, that was one of the goals, is that we start working together and talking to each other. And Dr. Huner and I have talked a bit about these kinds of questions, and I know, and Dr. Eaton, because I know what he does in his class. I've seen his syllabi and stuff. And we all are trying to accomplish similar things, as you say. But yeah, we don't talk to each other much about what we do on a day-to-day basis or share skills. And I think, you know, again, Mr. Brood yesterday was talking about the colleague that started to help develop these ideas about this very elaborate Michigan, as why is the automobile in Michigan? So yeah, that collaboration is always good for all of us at all levels.
So one of the struggles that teachers in world history have is learning enough content to be able to effectively teach.
Right.
So I was wondering what suggestions, I know Professor Eaton, you suggested the Swahili book. Mm. What, do you have a couple books that you'd recommend that aren't textbooks, that are actual books written by historians that would give them teachers a way to think about the sort of ideas you're talking about and provide some good content background in your area?
Yeah, and so I feel. Why don't you guys come up? Why don't you talk about your podcast and that too?
Oh, I can plug the podcast.
Plug the podcast, Dr.
Well, I think for me, teaching world history, the real challenge at the beginning is that you don't have any entry point to a lot of the debates. So it's very hard to know where to start. And what I found is I had to design a course based primarily on the textbook at the beginning, just because I didn't really know anything about, say, Buddhism, about, you know, debates over Buddhism. And over time, as I had more time myself, I could begin to read monographs on that. For me, with African history, the entry points maybe are a little bit different. There is a really good series of books done by Ohio University Press, though. It's an Africa in World History series of books. So Mugani's book on the story of Swahili, published in that. Another book by a prof at Michigan State, Peter Alleggi, he has a book called African Soccerscapes in that list as well. It's a really, really good one. I talked a bit about Crace and Scully there at Emory University. That university's really done a lot with the slave trade, so that book I really recommend. But you know, I think really most importantly is, in a way, it's about you. Your own experiences, your own courses, you're gonna have certain things that resonate with you. For me, soccer was one of them. I'm a huge Liverpool fan. I've been a Liverpool fan almost all my life. And I've been fascinated by the arrival of African players on a global stage. And this has happened very much in my own lifetime. It's something that I'm interested in to begin with. And so gradually I learned more about the history of its arrival. Again, I couldn't really go into that in much detail in my 4 or 5 minutes on the topic here. But that side of it, and then looking at it as a microcosm for the global economy, again, those were ideas that I developed more or less based on my own experience. When I was in Kenya, the public transit vehicles, they're these little matatus, they're like 13-seater vans, and all of them will have something painted on them to distinguish them from the other ones, or at least they did back in 05, 04. And there was a Liverpool one. There were numerous Chelsea ones, numerous Manchester United ones, numerous Arsenal ones. And the music I listened to was kind of Kenyan hip-hop, and a lot of Kenyan hip-hop songs actually mention or reference the Man U versus Arsenal rivalry. That, again, over here not a lot of people know, but this was an integral part of the culture of the people that I interacted with. When I was in Namalu, this tiny town in Uganda, you're a good 50 miles from the nearest power line, I remember being there in February in 2005, and hearing this noise from my hotel. I'm like, what's going on? And yeah, there was a guy with a generator and a satellite signal who was cranking out the Champions League game. This was between Liverpool and I think it was Juventus or someone like that. And I could watch Liverpool in the Champions League in a village 50 miles from power lines where most people make a living herding cattle. And that's what really made it hit home for me how important this was, that this might be a valuable form of entry. So I think for any instructor, I mean, that does have to start with you as well. I mean, I have my recommendations. Again, I'm not saying that Ohio University isn't a good starting point, but I think you also have to think, you know, for yourself, what have you noticed about maybe different parts of the world when you're reading the news, things that grab your attention? Those can be your entry points to really make you know, a very compelling class and one that you'll be passionate about because you're coming at it from that element.
I agree with everything. But some texts, actually, I will recommend. One actually is a textbook, but it doesn't read like a textbook. All right? And it's actually widely assigned, both on the secondary as well as college level, for Latin America. Just get a great overview of Latin America, and it's Born in Blood and Fire by John Chastain. Coincidentally, he was my advisor at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. But it is a really good textbook, and so that, it doesn't read like a textbook, right? It gives this narrative arc of Latin American history. One of the dangers of that, often, as I found, but using that book, is sometimes students begin to conflate Latin American countries together as one big, massive country, rather than all these diverse, different nation states. So that becomes an issue. But it's a really good book. But in terms of specific issues, especially stuff that I addressed, Matthew Restall, a professor of
Yucatec, my history and culture out of Penn State, wrote The Seven Myths of the Spanish Conquest, an excellent text to either assign to high school students or, if you're a teacher, to read it and get a better sense of what the Spanish Conquest was actually all about. I use it for my own presentation of the Spanish Conquest. That is certainly excellent. In terms of the Cold War, it's very polemical in Latin America, and so I would recommend a polemical book. Greg Brandon, Empire's Workshop. And so it's it would be a polemical book to get a discussion going in class. But indeed, he is certainly someone of the intellectual left in the United States who writes very well and very accessibly and addresses some of these issues that are raised. Why was the Cold War so hot in Latin America? And then with the soccer thing, I got to throw this in because obviously Latin America is a big place for soccer as well. Football, or Why the Soccer Matter in Latin America by Josh Nadel. A very good overview, but it gets kind of more to questions of nationalism, right? And so the question I would pose, the big question, the hook question that I would pose with respect to soccer in Latin America is how did soccer build modern nations? And so that, and that book addresses it quite nicely, but also brings up issues of race as well as globalization that would intersect with some of the stuff that Professor Eaton was talking about.
And we will let Dave Eaton plug his new podcast website on teaching world history. So what is it?
Oh, Doug? Yes. Mm-hmm. It's called On Top of the World, the World History Podcast. So we have 3 episodes up available on iTunes and Stitcher. And actually, one of the books I plug in that is Rascal's 7 Myths of the Spanish Conquest. Again, really recommend that. That's part of our review of Jerry Dutton's Guns, Germs, and Steel.
I was just going to make an observation about the soccer situation or the theme is that one of the things that seemed to me that was really interesting was if you take that soccer as a kind of beginning point, you use that as a jumping off point to explore things like nationalism, identity. What happens when you have all of these new soccer players? And then there are racial slurs, and there are fines, and there are problems with fans. What does that mean? What does it mean for France to have a national identity around people who look very different than traditional French people? How do you define, one person and the other? That then can, move forward to issues of migration. What's happening in Europe now? And all of these sorts of things. Can, it seems to me, unfurl from this. And so using these questions, rather than maybe, than an arc as an entry point, then to move out from that. Yep. So instead of an overarching theme as a point of entry.
And just to add on to that, when I teach it, the individual I use now is Mamadou Sakho. Mamadou Sakho is a defender for Liverpool. He actually scored a goal that sent France through to the 2014 World Cup in Rio. And Mamadou Sakho's parents are from Senegal. He was born in France, but he's a recent migrant. And it's funny because the first game, they did a head-to-head with Ukraine to get to the World Cup. The first game, they lost 2-0. And Marine Le Pen, who's a very sort of virulent right-wing conservative in France, said that the reason the team lost was because it wasn't French enough. And I'm not saying they were using coding, but it was very much a case of, this is a team of too many recent migrants from Guinea, recent migrants from Angola, recent migrants from Senegal. And the suggestion was this is why the team failed, that they didn't know the words to the national anthem. And then in the game, the final game of that head-to-head series, Sakho scores 2 goals and they end up winning 3-0 to win. And he stood up and said, listen, we stand for the real France, not the France, the old France of this old guard. We stand for the new France, the multicultural France. And there's a great article I used with my students where the guy says, FIFA's incredibly discriminatory because Africa is as big as Europe, it has as many countries as Europe, and in the World Cup it has 5 spots and Europe gets 13.
And, you know, it's not equal. But on the other hand, Africans are taking over European teams. So France and Belgium both got through on goals by strikers whose parents were born in Africa. And he says, well, at least the world's kind of evening it out a little bit. So this, for me, again, it's an entry point to a whole range of other issues. And I think with world history, it just can become very repetitive if everything is sort of, here's the politics, here's the economics, and going on that over and over and over again. And especially by the end of the course, the kids know they get, you know what I mean? And so again, it's trying to not tell them what's going on, it's show them using this different entry point to convey these ideas. Again, I think it makes it more engaging, and yeah, I really enjoyed it.
Yeah,
I think the most important part is at the high school level, making sure that the kids get the basics before you dive into that. I have all sorts of weird, wacky stories, which are always the best parts. The kids really dive in. And then before you know it, that discussion that was supposed to take 20 minutes, that just went 72, and now, crap, we can't get to that primary source. So we can't do this, can't do that. But it was a great day.
Right.
And I think that's always the biggest struggle, especially if you're dealing with freshmen and sophomores, is I would love to dive into that. Kid can't spell globalization. So now I gotta, okay, what do I pick and choose? Kind of going back to that C3 inquiry, I'm just because I know I also teach a biology course. It's basically a scientific method. That's all we're doing. The only question is, and that same idea, are we going too fast for some of these kids at the end? So like, at the beginning, I'd say probably want to avoid that because it almost looks like that project-based. And it gets very difficult. Kids don't have the basics, but by the time it gets like your world beat, you're starting to get to that bigger picture, that broader perspective. That's where I see that really being a good potential, especially because now we can use that globalization of the soccer. I see it as the early world. Again, I'm happy if my kids can figure out what that's going
to be. And I think you're right. I mean, the scary part is, you know, letting students loose on all this stuff. But on the other hand, when I think about the inquiry arc, it is also how I am approaching it myself. And even if it's largely teacher-directed instruction, it still is always we're going back to the questions. We're answering questions. See, when I'm giving this 10-minute lecture on this, it's about helping you answer this question, right? When I'm asking you to read the textbook for this, you're answering this question, right? That it's always built around we're trying to figure stuff out. So even if it is very teacher-directed, it could be even packets and worksheets and all the kind of stuff that we do in schools, it's always within this bigger frame of this is why we're learning it, right? I think trying to give students an intellectually honest reason why they need to know this stuff. We're trying to answer questions, and hopefully these are compelling questions and supporting questions that are engaging them in doing this, even if, yeah, at the beginning of the year, we're walking them through. I'm feeling it. This is my first time teaching World Civ at the college level, and it feels like I'm very much hand-holding them and working hard, and we're going to get this, and I'm hoping by the end of the semester I'm letting them loose a lot more. But that is that modeling and building it. So.
Well, I think one of the things I'm trying to do more, and I know this is anathema for a lot of instructors, for things where students can just look it up on their smartphones, I try to just let them do that. Now, I don't know if that would be ever allowed in a high school or especially elementary school where that's very discouraged. But my thinking on it is, as a professor, I'm supposed to be adding value, right? I shouldn't be spending a lot of time on things that they can look up on a smartphone. I should be trying to get them thinking about what they should be looking up on a smartphone in the first place. Mm-hmm. And that's been something that I'm trying to let go on a little bit. I don't worry about cell phones in class now. I don't worry about computers. Even if I'm walking down the aisle and I see Facebook out or Twitter or whatever, I'm just sort of like, oh, whatever. They'll come back if I ask the right questions kind of deal. But it's been something that I wish was possible at other levels as well, where there'd be less time spent on the memory work of, you know, where's Mesopotamia and that, where you can sort of almost outsource that. Just look it up, you know, like, or bring your phone, you can take a look at it in class, and then the bigger questions could then be more of a focus, maybe. Again, I don't know the specifics of the curriculum and whether that would be possible.
That's the idea, that they would look up Mesopotamia because they have an intellectual need to look up where Mesopotamia is. Like, there's a reason that they're learning this. It's not just so I can put it back on a test at the end. It's so I can understand better these bigger questions. That's the goal.
Talking about, like, the smartphone things,
our school, we give the kids MacBooks. We're very fortunate. We're on a one-to-one. And we found almost everybody that started off with MacBooks dove right in. It was an absolute train wreck. And the idea was, by the time they're seniors and juniors, it's great. We can really dive in. But freshmen, it is automatic. Facebook or some backdoor way to get to Facebook,
yeah.
YouTube, there's unbelievable distractions. And the same thing with the smartphones. We tried it, and it was distractions until your junior, senior, boom, they're at that point where you can say, hey, you're going to retake this class. So that's
yeah, yeah.
But you're a freshman, you got kind of more of that handhold back through.
Yeah.
So that's, it was interesting they brought that up.
Yeah.
Sadly, we have to stop. Thank you, panel. I really enjoyed it. And thank you, audience, for coming in today. And let's give everyone...